The standard definition of a health care worker is like everybody, practically everybody sitting in this particular auditorium today is a healthcare worker. Because either he has access to the patient or he has access to blood or body fluids of the patients, either in the healthcare setting or even in the laboratory. Now, what is the standard definition of exposure from the point of view of HIV? The exposure means either it could be a percutaneous exposure through sharp needle or through sharp instrument, or it could be even contact of mucous membrane, contact of non-intact skin, for instance, if the person is having dermatitis or any abrasion in the skin, or even contact of the intact skin if the exposure of long duration or the volume of infectious fluid is of sufficient quantity, or it could be even exposure in a laboratory. These are the standard definitions which have been defined by CDC in terms of exposure. Now, the common sites of exposures are either the skin because of the sharp injuries, it could be the mucous membrane in the mouth, it could be in the nose, it could even the conjunctiva because of a splash in the eyes. Now, how risky is the situation? You'll be in a way taken aback by this information that about 3,85,000 stick injuries and other sharp injuries per year, that which amounts to about 1,000 injuries per day among hospital workers in USA today. And all the more surprising or all the more thought-provoking is that 40 to 70% of such needle stick injuries are underreported. Now, if we go back to the history, how CDC has been monitoring the needle stick exposure, we found that there had been an alarming increase in the incidence of needle stick exposure from 1997 onwards in terms of number of percutaneous injuries, number of mucous membrane exposure per 100 beds. Now, in 2001, President Clinton introduced one act which is known as Needle Stick Safety and Prevention Act in order to modify the Occupational Safety and Health Administrator's guidelines. So this introduction of this particular act, which was initiated by President Clinton in 2001, we expected there will be a sharp decline in the incidence of sharp injuries or sharp decline in the mucous membrane injuries or the risky exposures. But to our utter surprise or to the disappointment of the general people or the globally, it didn't happen so. As you can see, even beyond 2001, beyond the introduction of this particular act, the incidence did not come down appreciably. It continued to be there, as much as people would have expected that it would happen because of the introduction of this particular act. Now, what are the key issues in a sharp injuries? First of all, who gets injured? Where do they happen? When do injuries occur? What devices are involved and how they can be prevented? The first one, who gets injured? Basically, globally, it has been found by and large everywhere, the nurses are the population who gets maximum affected, who gets maximum injured, followed by physicians, followed by technicians. Here, CDC has broadly clubbed the physicians. Don't think that they are only physicians as per our definition. The physicians group here means it also includes the surgeon, it also includes the obstetricians and gynecologists and all other specialties, medical specialties. So maximum for the nurses, followed by the physicians, which comprises the group of the clinicians, followed by technicians. Now, where do they happen? Maximum of the injuries, they happen in the inpatient's department, as much as in 40% of the cases, followed by operations rooms. Now, when do the injuries occur? So, maximum number of injuries, they happen during manipulation of the needle in the patient, as much as 26%, followed by during sharp disposal, around 13%, and then there are other, other situations when such injuries occur. For instance, the improper disposal during cleanup or even collision with a colleague worker or some with a sample. Now, by and large, if we broadly categorize, when the needle stick injuries occur, when actual exposure occurs, about 40% during use, 40% after use and before disposal, 50% during disposal and 5% the other instances or other situations. Now, what devices are involved? In most of the situations, we have a hollow bone needle which is involved, as much as 59%, nearly 60%, followed by the solid sharps, which comes around 34%. So, hollow bone needle accounts for more than, nearly double the amount of injuries compared to the solid sharp instrument. Now, time of injury, it is quite understandable, quite logical, that the most of the injuries will be happening at the peak hours of the activity of the day, where the healthcare is involved. Obviously, no wonder that the maximum incidences, they occur between 7 a.m. in the morning till 2 p.m. in the afternoon. Now, imagine the extent of exposure, the clinical disciplines they have in terms of specialty. The surgery, obstetrician, gynae, invasive radiology, emergency, and dentistry. Look at the figure of surgery, for instance, number of procedures with more than one blood contact and number of procedures with more than one sharp injury. The surgeons, they have 6.4 to 50, instance percentage of the procedures where there is at least one blood contact. There are about 1.3 to 15.4 percentage of procedures where there is at least more than one sharp injury. Similarly, the figures are very high for in the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology. Of course, they are very less, much less in invasive radiology, emergency room, and dentistry. Now, having said all this, having more or less convinced or having accepted the fact that the exposures of needle stick injuries or sharps, they do happen every day in terms of thousands in number. But when you actually come to count, the number of HIV infections actually happened in the healthcare setting because of such extensive exposures, the number comes to a meager 58 globally. That's something very, very unusual, that we have exposure in terms of thousands per day. Yet globally, we have only 58 cases reported to CDC so far. Why such discrepancy? What is this paradox is all about? Because number one factor is the survival capacity of HIV. HIV is supposed to be, in terms of the microbiological standards, a very, very fragile virus. It's very weakly stable in the outside condition, environmental conditions. So it dies up very fast. Number two is that the report says, or the data say, that the percentage of, the proportion of people who get exposed to HIV positive blood through needle stick injury, only 0.3% of them, they get actual HIV infection. Maybe because of the vulnerability or the fragility of the virus, whatsoever be the reason. The fact remains is that not even 3% of the cases where there is needle stick exposure to an HIV positive blood or infectious material, the number of seroconversion is less than 0.3%. Now, a breakup of these 58 cases, mostly they are confined to nurses and lab technicians. Together, they comprise around 80% of the cases. Of course, the physicians, they contribute to 10.3% of the cases. Now, root of these 58 cases, percutaneous puncture or cut accounts for 84.5%, followed by mucocutaneous exposure, and then percutaneous and mucocutaneous, as well as unknown, the numbers are still less. Now, in terms of exposure material, the HIV-infected blood, it is around 85%, concentrated virus in the lab, few cases, still lesser number of cases in terms of visible body fluid and unspecified body fluid. Now, this is something which I thought that I must let you know. The percentage of seroprevalence of HIV infection among the healthcare or selected healthcare workers in USA. Mind you, here the proportion of healthcare workers does not mean that all of them have acquired the HIV infection through occupational exposure. This is the total number of HIV prevalence among them. So the surgeons, you can see that 0.13%, that is one more than one surgeon in 1,000. They are HIV positive, and not necessarily that they have picked up HIV positive because of the occupational exposure. They might have picked up because of some other reason. Similarly, you can have a look over here, the hemodialysis staff. About 12 per 1,000 of the hemodialysis staff, they are HIV positive in USA. Not necessarily that picked up through the occupational exposure. The data says, the fact says, only 4% of the healthcare workers with HIV infection, that HIV infection have been picked up through occupational exposure. But they are also, after all, human beings. Surgeons are not nothing about the human, humanity. They can have high risk behaviors. You can't prevent them. Many of them may be drug addicts. Maybe many of them may be having unsafe sex or whatsoever it is. All I wanted to say that there is a palpable portion of healthcare professionals who are otherwise HIV positive. Now, if that be the case, we can expect there will be few cases of HIV infection which has transmitted from a healthcare worker to a patient, which means from a surgeon to a patient, from a dentist to a patient, from an obstetrician and gynecologist to a patient. If this be the case, that they are that high percentage of the healthcare workers, they are HIV positive. But incidentally, there are only 4 documented cases of transmission of HIV infection from a healthcare worker to a patient. First one is the latest one is 2006 Spain. There's a female patient infected by obstetrician during emergency cesarean. The surgeon, a gay man, did not know that he was HIV positive. In 1996 France, one patient was infected by a nurse. In 1992 in the same country, one patient was infected by a surgeon during his hip replacement. In 1990 USA, 6 patients infected by a dentist became famous as a legal issue for compensation. I remember that when I was in US, this thing was going on. Series of trials, series of hearings in the legal court about this particular dentist, about the compensation which the patients demanded from the dentist. But in any case, there are only 4. Whether you call it only 4, or you just think why there should be even 4 cases, I'll leave it to you. Now, this is a review of some of the reports from India. I tried to work on in last couple of days to find out the literature, they are available in Indian front. There are some about 14 of them which I could collect, and I have gone through of them, including one of the last one which is an unpublished work by one of my MPH student, Dr. Deepankar Malik, who is now is in US. He had his dissertation under me while pursuing his MPH course. He had also a topic on occupational exposure. Anyway, these are some of the reports from various cities in India. Now, what are the overall expected findings? Usual thing is very much, there that first of all, there is no single documented kind of seroconversion. Despite 2.8% to 19.2% of the source being HIV positive, except one case. This is in line with the kind of findings which I found that thousands of HIV workers exposed, yet 58 got actually seroconverted. In India also, no wonder that even as high as 19%, 20% of the source patients being HIV positive, yet there is only one documented case of HIV seroconversion in a healthcare worker. And then otherwise, things are more or less similar. So nurses have more incidence compared to the residents, type of device, all over needles. This is nothing unusual. This is what we have discussed, what we have seen in the CDC report. Something, which is some of the findings which are there more prevalent in the developing countries, like under-reporting, poor knowledge about reporting, lack of knowledge about PEP availability, poor adherence to universal precautions. Many of them, they are not wearing gloves. And these are some of the findings which we do not expect in a civilized country or a developed country, but we do expect in a developing country like India. Then some of the lacunae which I found in this particular study when I was reviewing all these 14-15 articles. Number one is that the definition of healthcare worker has been used very loosely. I do not know, some reason or other, the surgeons, the obstetricians and gynecologists, the specialists or the consultants, they have not been included in most of the studies. So the definition of healthcare worker was not a very foolproof one. It definitely excluded a sizable portion of healthcare workers like consultants, surgeons, obstetrician, gynecologists who are actually performing their duties. They are not included. Another lacunae which I found is garbage cleaning staff. That is not included. Except one study or two studies where they have included the incidence of prevalence of occupational exposure to blood among the garbage cleaners. Most of the studies, they did not think it necessary to include the garbage cleaners, which is, I believe in a developing country like India, that's an important target population which you should take into account. Another is the definition of exposure. Many people have given the title of their topics as occupational exposure to blood, yet actually in terms of doing the work, they have only done the needles, they have suffered the needle stick injuries. But as we have seen, that occupational exposure does not necessarily mean needle stick injury. It does also increase the mucosal exposure, splash on the mucous membrane and everything. So the definition of exposure has been loosely used. Now, this is the only one case which I was referring to, which has been reported from India. That's in Kolkata. A female nurse got injured while performing a duty in a nursing home from a patient who was HIV positive. And this is the first only documented case, because why I say it is documented, you will soon realize that it is very important to document that the victim or the exposed was HIV negative at the time of exposure, and she eventually became HIV positive after say some duration, 2 months or 3 months. It's very important. If the victim was already exposed or already HIV positive, we cannot conclusively say that it has been occupationally acquired. So this is only one instance from Kolkata that a female nurse got HIV infection from a source patient who was HIV positive. And now the reason, you might be wondering, what could be the reason that several thousands of healthcare workers got exposed, yet only 58 of them, got actually seroconverted. What could be the reason? What was the reason of such a grinding halt? The reason is this, that in 1996 or somewhere, the PEP recommendation, post-exposure prophylaxis recommendations were introduced. That could have done the magic. That could have resulted in such a, drastic halt in the number of, cases seroconverting following exposure. Because you can see hardly there is any case beyond that. That underscores the importance of post-exposure prophylaxis, which you are going to discuss. Now, what are the determinants, the probabilities, which may determine the probabilities of HIV transmission? First of all, obviously, volume of blood. Secondly, stage of HIV illness in the source, because if the source is terminally ill, automatically the load of virus in his blood will be very high. Automatically, the chance of probability becomes very high. Depth of injury, if it's a deep injury, logically one can expect that the chances of transmission will be more. Direct access to sharp to the vein or artery, if the sharp or the needle or the sharp object had been directly accessed to the artery or blood, obviously the infection will be spreading much more successfully, much more faster. Host immune status, if the host is deficient in immunological status or deficient in self-mediated immunity, obviously the chance of transmission is much higher. And post-exposure prophylaxis is the most important factor. If the exposed person, whether he has taken post-exposure prophylactic immediately or not, well within time or not, that's also an important determinant. Now, as we can see, these are the events what happens after entry of the virus. For about one day, it remains within the mucosa. It takes about 2 to 3 days for the virus to migrate to the regional lymph node. And another 5 days, by fifth day or so, it comes into the blood. So we have ample time. We have ample time. The virus is there here for one full day. So if you can do something at this particular stage, possibly the virus will not be able to cross from here to the regional lymph node. That's the reason it is said that if you want to give post-exposure prophylaxis or any medication, give it as early as possible, preferably within 2 hours. This is the logic, because the journey of the virus, it takes a couple of days, before it reaches the blood. Now, why post-exposure prophylaxis has been so effective? One of the things we have seen, that the cases have had a grinding halt beyond 1996. Out of 58 cases, hardly one or two cases beyond the period when PEP was introduced. One evidence was there. There are other supportive evidence. Animal studies have proved that PEP is successful in preventing the transmission. There are studies, obviously we have seen the figures, they say that thousands of exposures, yet only 58 cases, and that those 58 cases, hardly any case are beyond 1996 when PEP was introduced. Now, eligibility for PEP. As I said, the exposure will pass 72 hours. We have seen in that particular figure that there is no point in giving PEP if it is late enough, because by the time it reaches the blood, hardly there is any scope or any rationality giving post-exposure prophylaxis. Then it doesn't become prophylaxis, then it becomes a kind of treatment, you can say. So if you are thinking in terms of prophylaxis, it should be given within first 72 hours. So second is that source person is a known HIV positive. If the source is HIV negative, there is the person, exposed person is safe, there is no point in giving PEP. Third is that exposed person is not a known HIV positive. If the person is already HIV positive, I know one case of a Maran Nazar technician who at that time there was a provision of claiming some 1 lakh rupees as a compensation if you get HIV infection in the workplace. So she came with the claim that I have become infected HIV positive in the case, HIV because of my needle stick injury, and I would like to lodge some kind of application for claiming this compensation. What we thought to do, the very first thing is to draw a baseline sample from that particular individual and do HIV testing. To our surprise, it was found that she is already HIV positive, which means she has not picked up that, there is no chance that she can say that she is going to pick up the HIV, because if she wants to become, the serological positivity takes about 2 to 3 weeks to appear. It cannot just happen that that she is HIV positive just overnight because of that needle stick injury. So her case was rejected. That's all the more reasons that whenever there is any case of needle stick injury and there is any claim that it has, the HIV infection has been acquired because of the needle stick injury, it's very important to have a baseline status at the point of injury, at the time of injury for the HIV. So if the individual is already HIV positive, there is no point in giving prophylaxis to the person. Now, as I said, the PEP should be given as early as possible, preferably within 2 hours. And then there are, you know, various categories on the basis of which it is decided whether any PEP will be given. If at all PEP will be given, basic regime will be given. If at all PEP is to be given, whether advanced regime or, you know, what you call it, they do call it expanded regime. To be given. That has to be decided based on two factors. Based on, number one is the exposure. What category of exposure is there? If the exposure is from HIV negative, obviously there is no point in giving any, giving any PEP. Or if there is a splash on the intact skin which does not amount for any possibility of transmission of HIV, there is no point in giving PEP. However, there are two situations where PEP can be concerned. One is the percutaneous exposure, the another is mucous membrane exposures. There, accordingly, it is decided, you know, the exposure code. Another thing is decided about the status code. What is the status of the source? The source, if it is HIV negative, there is no PEP is necessary. The source could be HIV positive. The source could be unknown. Maybe, you know, that somebody has just inflicted one needle stick injury and just ran off. You are not able to trace. So source you do not know. Source is unknown. As well as you don't know the HIV status of the source. And another possibility is status unknown. The source refuses to submit any blood sample for testing. So you are not able to decide whether the person is whether HIV positive or not. So these are some of the situations. Now, having, you know, combination of these situations, one can decide whether PEP has to be given or whether the basic regime has to be given. Or the expanded regime has to be given. I'm not going into the details because it's probably a job of the clinician to decide which is to be given, but we can always supplement the information which can decide these combinations, whether what is the exposure code, what is the status code. Okay. HIV is more sensitive to environmental conditions compared to hepatitis B virus. The mode of transmission of hepatitis B is similar to that of HIV. Therefore, little bit of care on controlling hepatitis B would also take care of transmission of HIV. Thirdly, we had greater, by the time the HIV or AIDS came into our life or into the scenario, we had extensive knowledge about hepatitis B virus, how it is transmitted and how it can be prevented, what are the casualties and all. See, for instance, 2.5% of global AIDS cases are occupationally acquired. On the other hand, 40 to 50% of global hepatitis B and C cases are occupationally acquired. See the quantum magnitude of problem in terms of hepatitis B. See the quantum of knowledge we had about hepatitis B. Then WHO estimates that worldwide about 66,000 cases of hepatitis B virus infection and 261 hepatitis B related deaths among healthcare workers are caused by contaminated sharp injuries each year. Imagine the amount of human loss because of hepatitis B virus. Having collected all these informations, there has been a sufficient reason for me to feel guilty when I'm 1978, when I was doing my residency in internal medicine, one of my senior residents posted in dialysis unit. He just suffered from acute pulmonating hepatitis, virus infection. You must be knowing what is there is a clinical condition known as acute pulmonating hepatitis, where the liver just melts like a butter. And within 21 days, we couldn't save him. He was a doctor. And it created such a dent in my mind that I cannot just tell you, seeing, having witnessed that particular casualty. He died of hepatitis B virus infection. When I started doing my MD in 1982, in Radiology Medical College, no one prevented me wearing a gloves and all, no one cautioned me. No one prevented me doing a mouth pipetting, no one told me to wash the hands. Yet, we had been having casualties of hepatitis B viral infections right and left around us. There was no human cry about that. I was in a position to have some say about the policy makers, to the policy when I became additional director, and I had some say in the NACO, National AIDS Control Organizations. I could only register as some kind of protest that we all of us, we have done something which is very, very criminal. if we would have taken a little bit of care of preventing hepatitis B virus infection, we would have definitely saved many more lives, and we would not have to bother about HIV infection in the occupational setting. Well, because the HIV is far more, is far less healthy compared to hepatitis B virus. With this particular kind of note, which is little maybe personal, emotional, and sentimental, I'd like to thank the audience for patient hearing. Thank you, sir.
Who is expert in venereal disease and STDs, and HIV is very much part of the STDs.
Good afternoon, everybody. So I'll be talking about clinical aspects and management of HIV/AIDS. I'll be sharing my own experience because in Army we used to follow all these HIV patients, HIV positive patients in the Department of Dermatology and Immunology. All the surveillance centers were with the dermatologists, and when they became AIDS, then they were taken over by the medical specialists. So I'll be sharing my experience because we have done a lot of studies on this, and I'll be extrapolating all my studies into this presentation. Now, I'll be covering this topic with CDC classification. What is the definition of AIDS? What is the natural course of this disease? Then I'll be talking also about what is the role of STDs in HIV transmission. Few of the oropharyngeal markers of HIV, diagnosis of HIV. Then one of the studies which we have done on significance of tubuclin testing in Indian settings. Then a few lines about treatment, though I have no experience in managing HIV patients, and then I'll be concluding that. Now, as per the classification given by CDC in 1993, you see all these red. That means all the cases who have CD4 count less than 200, or all those cases who are category C conditions, are labeled as AIDS. Now, as per the definition, any patient with CD4 count less than 200 cells per cubic millimeter in any category C condition will be labeled as AIDS. Now, after a high risk exposure, within 2 weeks, with an average of 5 to 90 days, there is acute seroconversion. And this acute seroconversion is a clinical illness which may last for about 2 weeks. They will have fever, they will have skin rashes and lymphadenopathy. Then they go into an asymptomatic phase when the HIV is in the blood but there are no symptoms, and then gradually there is enlargement of the lymph nodes, what we call as a clinical stage of progressive generalized lymphadenopathy. After the body immunity goes down, they go into regression of all these lymph nodes. And then they start developing category B conditions. We'll come to these category B conditions. And then after progression of the disease, after 2 to 10 years, they develop AIDS, or what we call as category C conditions. Now, coming to category C conditions, now we studied 612 cases who had reported to us who are HIV positive. And what we found was that none of the case was detected to be HIV positive due to acute seroconversion. So this is the first stage of category A condition. Most of the patients were detected during asymptomatic infection. That means almost 45% of the patients were detected when they were not having any symptoms of HIV infection. Then, as per the definition of PGL, the lymph node should be more than 1 centimeter in size at 2 or more extra environment sites, or they should be lasting for more than 3 months or longer, and should not be attributable to any other disease, and they should not be associated with any other constitutional symptoms. So this is the definition of PGL. Now, what we found, this was another study which was published by us in 2008. What was the lymphoreticular involvement in human immunodeficiency virus infection? Now only 5, that means 0.82% patient presented with lymphadenopathy. So they came and they found that they're having some gland, and they came for investigation to the patient, and they were found to be HIV positive. But on examination, out of these 612 cases, 300 are that is almost 50% had generalized lymphadenopathy. It was bilateral in most of the cases. These are the regions which were involved: cervical, axillary, retroperitoneal, epitrochlear, supraclavicular, submandibular, hilar, and postauricular. Now, if they are unilateral, then suspect something which is not because of HIV. So they may have developed complications of HIV or may have developed other infections like tuberculosis, where it is unilateral, asymmetrical, or they may be developing some malignancy. So when it is unilateral, suspect that it is not because of HIV. So method in the setting of tuberculosis in 2%, hepatomegaly in almost 1/6 of the patients, and splenomegaly in almost 1/10 of the patients. So these are our findings. Now in category B conditions, category B includes fever which is lasting for more than 1 month of duration, weight loss of more than 10% in last 3 months, and diarrhea lasting for more than 1 month duration. Now 10% of the patients presented with these constitutive symptoms and they were diagnosed to be HIV positive. Now in category B condition we also have herpes zoster. Now this is the third most common presentation what we found. Almost 14% of the patients presented with herpes zoster, and what we saw was that herpes zoster ophthalmicus was much more common in HIV positive setting than in HIV negative setting. In advanced case of AIDS, it is more likely to be multidermatomal, hemorrhagic, and atypical as compared to when the CD4 count is still more than 200. Oral pharyngeal candidiasis, again a cutaneous marker of HIV. It was found in 2.45% of the cases, and then they can be vulvovaginal candidiasis. Once the candidiasis involves the esophagus, it becomes a category C condition. So once it travels down, then it becomes a category C condition. So some of the other category B conditions are ITP, dysterosis, oral hemolytic, peripheral neuropathy, PID, HIV wasting syndrome, and bacillary angiomatosis, and CIN, cervical neoplasia, intraepithelial neoplasia. Now in the category C conditions, now the most common was tuberculosis. So this was the most common presentation in the 612 cases which we studied, that almost 28% of tuberculosis patients when they were investigated for HIV were found to be HIV positive. And amongst the tuberculosis, pulmonary tuberculosis was more common, affecting 67% of the cases, and extrapulmonary was only 32% of the cases. Then other categories, C conditions, infection, atypical mycobacterial infection, recurrent salmonella, septicemia, recurrent bacterial pneumonia, which we found in 1.47% of other cases, multiple and recurrent pyogenic infection in less than 30 years age. Now other infections are viral infections caused by CMV. CMV is again a virus which is present in the body, and when the body immunity falls due to HIV infection, they may develop manifestation of CMV infection like CMV retinitis or disseminated CMV infection in more than 1 month old, or herpes simplex infection in more than one month old child. Among the fungal infection, as I have already said, esophageal candidiasis were found in one patient in the category C condition, trichobronchial candidiasis, histoplasmosis, and cryptococcus. The PCP pneumonia, this was the first thing which was detected in a AIDS patient. When it was first reported, the homosexuals were reported to be having PCP pneumonia, and when they were investigated, they were found to be positive. Toxoplasma gondii infection, Cryptosporidiasis causing diarrhea, Cryptosporidiasis of more than 1 month duration. Among the CNS infection, we have PML and AIDS dementia complex. Then, as the body immunity goes down, they are more likely to develop malignancies like Kaposi sarcoma, cervical cancer, primary CNS lymphoma, non-Hodgkin lymphoma, and lymphoid interstitial pneumonitis, and permanent lymphoid aplasia in less than 13 years of age. Now, after having seen what are the category B and C conditions, let's see what impact the STDs have over HIV infection. Now, if they are ulcerative STDs like this in a case of a chancroid, it increases the transmission of HIV fourfold. Firstly, there is a breach in the barrier so that the HIV virus can enter faster. And then there is recruitment of CD4 cell count. Any site of inflammation, there is more recruitment of CD4 positive cells which will carry the HIV virus to the blood. Non-ulcerative STDs, they increase the transmission of HIV by threefold. Now, HSV virus, it also acts as a cofactor for replication of HIV. So, those who are infected with both HSV and HIV, the AIDS policies were being laid out. The NACO decided that all the STDs should be treated by the peripheral doctors only. So, they came up with a syndromic approach. Before they go to the specialist, they should be treated by the primary health physician. So, they came with various syndromic management. STDs can be as fast as possible to reduce the viral load and reduce the transmission of HIV infection. So these are various syndromes. I will not go into the details. Gentler ulcer syndrome, urethral discharge, Guillain-Barré syndrome, vaginal discharge syndrome, lower abdominal pain because of pelvic inflammatory disease, scrotal swelling because of epididymitis as a complication of gonorrhea and gonorrheal infection, and conjunctivitis in the neonate because of chlamydia and gonorrhea acquired by the neonate while passing through the genital tract. Now, what we have seen, observed is that the number of conventional STDs has come down in HIV positive patients over the years. In 1991 to 96, we had seen almost 34% patients also having other STDs in the HIV positive patients. But after that, from 1997 to 2002, this percentage has come down to less than 10%. So the conventional STDs, possibly because of the syndromic management, the STDs were being treated, but HIV infection they had acquired. Now STDs, so all the STD cases were being investigated for HIV infection as well. So this was found to be the fourth most common mode of detection after tuberculosis, which I have already said, screening for blood donation, and herpes zoster, which I have already mentioned. Now, majority of these patients were detected during surveillance. It is understood because the seroconversion will occur any time between 2 to 3 weeks to 90 days. So when they present with the STDs like ulcerative disease or urethritis, they will be HIV negative, but because we have very good surveillance system in armed forces, so they were all being put on surveillance for 6 months and they were found to be HIV positive as well later on. Now, this HIV also modifies the presentation of STDs. Now, it can give rise to false negative EDR, though they may be having syphilitic infection because the body is not able to put up an immune reaction, so their VDRL may be non-react. We may have cases of early onset neurosyphilis. This was a case which we had reported. He had presented in Kottayam, diagnosed as viral encephalitis, then transferred. He developed abnormal behavior, and when his CSF was done, cell count as well as the proteins was raised. Then he was found to be HIV positive, and then we had when his blood was found to be VDRL reactive, he asked for a CSF VDRL and it was found to be reactive. So he was treated as syphilitic meningoencephalitis with that in a HIV setting. or they can have pathogenic, very destructive ulcers in shank organ. They can have multiple molluscum contagiosum, large molluscum contagiosum on the face. Now, we also studied CD4, CD8, CD4, CD8 ratio in 36 cases with various orocutaneous manifestations. And what we found was that all the cases with oral mucosal candidiasis had CD4 count less than 200. We also found that patients who were diagnosed with herpes zoster at that time the CD4 count was less than 200. But those who had a past history of herpes zoster, their CD4 count was more than 200. Thereby implying that possibly during the attack of herpes zoster, the CD4 count may be coming down, but later on the CD4 count rises. So it cannot be labeled as AIDS defining criteria. Other manifestations like seborrheic dermatitis, scabies, Bessarian angiomatosis, HPV infection, molluscum, dermatophytosis, acanthosis, they cannot be considered AIDS defining illnesses. Case of extensive dermatophytosis. Warts. Abscess ulcer in one patient. Herpes simplex infection. So these are other cases we have found in HIV positive patients. Now coming to the diagnosis. Now, either we can detect the antibody in the blood by doing an ELISA test, or we can do a Western blot test. We look for three antibodies to P24 antigen, group glycoprotein 120, 160, or glycoprotein 41. If two bands are positive, we diagnose HIV positive. If one is positive, then it is a doubtful case, and patient is kept under surveillance, and again this test is repeated. Or we can detect the antigen, either by doing P24 antigen assay. So we have done a study that we can, if we do in early case of HIV, those who are HIV negative by antibody detection, we can pick up the antigen faster in 2.3% of the HIV patients. So they were HIV negative by antibody, but we could pick up P24 antigen. Or we can do a PCR study, DNA, RNA, or reverse transcriptase PCR. Or we can do a viral test. So these are various modalities of investigating a case of HIV infection. Then we have to look for the disease progression. In this we have CD4, CD8 counts, ratio. We can look for viral RNA copies, neoprene assay, or beta 2 metabolome. So this will tell us the progression of the disease. As we put them on treatment, the viral RNA copies will start falling. The CD4 count, if it is falling, that means the disease is progressing. Then we have to look for the complications occurring in a case of HIV. Routine investigations, X-ray chest, tubercle testing, we will calibrate on this a little more, endoscopy to look for CMV infection, ultrasound. Now, this is a study we did for tubercle testing in Indian setting. What recommendations were there in the Western book was that anybody in a HIV setting more than 5 mm positivity for tuberculin should be put on chemoprophylaxis for tuberculosis. But we are endemic for both tuberculosis in India, for tuberculosis as well as HIV at that time. So our patients are likely to acquire infection even when the CD4 count is good, more than 500. What we saw in more than 45% of the cases, they had more than 10 millimeter tuberculin testing positivity. And if it was nil in duration, then they were like, and with CD4 count less than 200, they were more likely to have tuberculosis. So we recommended that all cases of tuberculin skin testing of more than, equal to or more than 10 millimeter, and with nil in duration and CD4 count less than 200, should be considered high risk for developing tuberculosis and should be administered tuberculosis. we look for other STDs in these patients of HIV positivity. I'll not be covering much on treatment because I have no experience. So these are the various groups of. Now, the most common presentation of HIVs, they were detected with tuberculosis or amongst the blood donors, herpes zoster in young or STDs. Now, number of cases who are diagnosed during acute seroconversion was nil. But if we do P24 or PCR in those patients who are suspected, we can pick up HIV positivity even during acute seroconversion. There is a question mark whether now we are having more of viral STDs or chlamydial STDs, and the conventional STDs are falling as such. We hardly find a case for examination also of ulcerative STDs. Oral candidiasis continues to be the most common cutaneous marker of AIDS, and CD4 count in majority of the cases of herpes zoster, as I already said, was found to be less than 200 during the acute attack, but it cannot be taken as AIDS defining criteria. And this recommendation I have already mentioned. Thank you.
Seeing all these manifestations of the skin. So let me give you good news, some of the good news about HIV/AIDS. What are the good news? We may be having AIDS-free generation. So that is the good news with your all efforts. What happened? During 2011 and 15, we used to have one theme only. Zero new HIV infection, zero discrimination, zero AIDS-related death. Now 2015 has come, we have reached only to zero discrimination in India also. But zero new incidents and zero death we have not reached. So what we have been decided by the government and the UN? So there was a meeting on this 30th of October recently during Indo-African Met. And UN also having the same meeting, had same meeting 1 week earlier. So they have decided, let's work faster. Now this complacency should go out. So what they have decided? They have decided that we will have fast track action to reach to the AIDS free generation. That means that by 2020 we will have 90-90-90. This was supposed to be by 2015, but now it is 2020. So we will have all the cases who are staying with HIV AIDS will be detected 90% by 2020 and 95% by 2030. And then all those who are detected will be put on ART. And those are put on ART, 90% will have effective suppressive viral load. So they will have good quality of life. And the generation will also not be affected. So these are the basic key factors. At present, all over world, 34 million lives have been lost. And 1.5 million deaths have taken place last year, in 2014 figures. That is the world figures. At present, in worldwide, we are expecting that 36.9 million people are living with HIV. And 25.8%, 70% of the population is considered in sub-Sahara Africa. So main problem is the African region. And 2 million newly infected cases which were detected in 2014, the 70% were detected in African region. So why we should have prevention? Why we are here? Because there is no cure for HIV. However, effective treatment with anti-ART treatment can control the virus so that people can have lengthy life and trouble-free lives. So prevention is the best thing for the HIV and to achieve the AIDS-free society. Currently, 50% people know their HIV status. So we want to reach to 95% to reach to the AIDS-free generation. And only 40% are receiving ART. So it has to be about 100% or at least 90% as far as target is concerned. So that is the strategy for the future control. This is the current situation. In India, up to 2003, the epidemic was going on, 2003-04. After 2004, when the ART was introduced, the epidemic has come down. This was the peak, 2003-04. Now it is coming down. All cases, all deaths, everything is going down. So what we have achieved? AIDS, mortality has decreased 27% since 2007 in India.
57% decrease in new cases in India. I'm taking the Indian situation. 30% of the people are unaware, 70% are not yet detected in India. So this is our raw area. 8 lakh people are receiving ART out of these. This also we have to increase it. Only 13,000 women in ANCs who are estimated as a HIV infected, only 13,000 have been detected.
So ANC detection also has to strengthen.
So these are our raw areas. So we have to commit this. So India is committed to achieve the AIDS free society by 2013. This is the situation mainly above average. This northeast state main problem is the intravenous drug users. They are the main problem. Nagaland, Mizoram, and Manipur. That is due to the all the IUD users, intrauterine drug users. Intravenous drug users. Then Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Chhattisgarh, Gujarat, Maharashtra. Few pockets are there in the
bridging population like truckers and the commercial sex workers and the other source infected people, they are also causing problems.
Main route of transmission is still in India is heterosexual transmission. 86% is due to the unsafe, unprotected sexual practices, basically more in the commercial sex workers. Others are minor, but they can also be causing the problem. We are taking actions. The main trend I told, the rate of the new infection has gone down and death have been also down. Main risk factor at present are because we are having unprotected anal or vaginal sex. In the homosexuality is also problem which is causing the problem. Having another STI like syphilis, Dr. Swami has already deliberated, is also main risk group. Then needle and syringe, especially in North State, is one of the major risk group. And then receiving unsafe injections in healthcare setting, which Dr. Devasis has deliberated, experienced accidental needle stick injury is another thing. And the vertical transmission from parents to child. So what are the basic prevention and control activities we are following? And the government is advocating prevention through health education. That is the main thing. Everybody should know what is their status. Everybody should be guided. Everybody should be counseled. And now the discrimination is almost over. So people are coming forward also. Then prevention of the blood-borne infections. Basically the high-risk group.
All the blood, all the blood banks, all the blood transfusion, everything screened. Blood banks has been, as per the regulations, they are supposed to be registered, should have all the facilities.
So all these things are due to regulatory approach and due to the administrative approach, everything is coming under control. Heat treatment of factor 8 and 9 for hemophilic patients, that is also required to, is advocated by the NECO, because the problem is coming in the hemophilic patients also. That's why positivity has been detected, transmitted through the blood transfusion. And using the pre-sterile disposal syringe for all activities, and it is better to add the injection if it is possible. The male and female condoms. Now female condoms are also there in the market, and the government is will be supplying free also. It is found that various trials have shown that the 85% HIV transmission can be stopped if the male condom is used properly. Then testing and counseling, HIV and STI, this integrated testing, counseling and blood transfusion centers, and all these counseling centers have been provided with these testing services. 25% death in HIV infected are due to TB. So the TB and the HIV infection, now they are collaborating together. They have got linkage, and all the HIV patients and those who are found this MANTU positive also, more than 5, they are also given the TB prophylaxis also. Then voluntary medical circumcision, this is advocated mainly in the African region. Indian government is not precising on, but it has been found 60% reducing the incidence in the transmission. ART used for prevention by infecting person to the other partner also. It has been advocated if ART is given for prevention for the risk group and commercial sex workers, then 96% reduction also has been found in various studies. And pre-exposure prophylaxis for men who have sex with men, basically homosexuals, the pre-exposure prophylaxis also has been advocated by using the ART long line. Then harm reduction, the injection safety, opioid, this the needle, the syringe exchange program is already advocated and is being implemented by the Indian government. Opioid substitute therapy also has been allocated specially to the those who are using pathetic injections. HIV testing counseling centers, HIV treatment care, access to condom, management of STI and TB, viral hepatitis, everything is being provided to these people, those who are addicted to the drugs and those who are likely to use the common syringe and the needles. Elimination of mother to child transmission, now the ART is advocated to the mother and child also throughout life to have a continuous good life and having AIDS-free generations. Anti-ART treatments for the infants, children, as per the recommended status and occupational exposure prophylaxis, which Dr. Devasis has already covered, is also on the available in the national program and to all the ART centers. Specific prophylaxis, especially for the infections, which Dr. Sani has told, for the opportunistic infections. It will give the quality of life improves, the morbidity and mortality will also decrease. And the government policy is that everything will be integrated in primary health care. Everything will be available at PSC level and district level. Though then you need to refer to the specialist centers. Basically, the National AIDS Control Program was started in 1992, if you say. Because in 1986, there just National AIDS Committee was formed. Then India was denying that we have different cultures, so HIV AIDS is not there in India. Then some cases were detected having found positive. And in 1990, then the National AIDS Control Program first phase was started. Stopping the spread of infection, because some cases are positive, let's stop the transmission. And this was only for the health education and the awareness of the population. After 5 years, then National AIDS Control Phase 2 was started, which focused on the behavior change and the decentralization. That they told, okay, central government cannot do it, let's change, decentralize to the state. That's why the state committee, State AIDS Control Society, was also formed in all the states. And the National AIDS Control Policy was announced in 2002. And blood safety policies, all these things, and the blood bank registration, everything came. And ART was introduced in 2004, and after that, the epidemic has come down sharply. And now NSP3 was up to 2013. Now 2014, we are having NSP. The main focus is the infrastructures. Prevention, target, group interventions, care, support, and treatment of the persons who are already having HIV, and the nationwide. The static information management system with feedback and monitoring of the system. These are some of the photos of the government efforts which they have done in early stage. There is an express train and then the 24 hours hotline for the information of the public. The universal precaution is one of the them for the health cares. I'll not deliberate because Dr. Devasis has already told. Everything which is which is not found, or if you don't have proof that is ineffective, then universal precaution has to be taken in handling that. The waste management, safe waste management, is also part of the healthcare system, and it's required. The rule is there to have a safe disposal of the biomedical waste. All the categories they have been given, all these 10 categories, all the wards, labels are there. Even the color coding has been started in the hospitals. This is regulated by all the regulating authorities, yellow, red and blue colors you might have seen the wards. So this is required to be implemented strictly. Then transportation of the segregation, transportation and the proper management of the
waste is also required. In our system,
there is a provision also that it can be outsourced also if somebody doesn't have facilities. So
our hospital has outsourced,
but it's required to be properly incinerated, autoclaving, neutralization, chemical, all these
required at various level has to be done. What about a
vaccine?
What is the current status of the vaccines?
The International AIDS Vaccine Initiative, in short known as IAVI, they are very active since 1985. And about 30 candidate vaccines have been tried. But no vaccine has been licensed yet. So some of the vaccines, they have given some positive results. But no vaccine has been found to be effective till now. Challenges are because HIV variability, somewhere HIV 1 is there, somewhere HIV 2 is there, somewhere mix is, HIV strain is there. Then HIV target cell of immune system because they are already the HIV vaccine as the targeting immune system. So immunity cannot be boosted unless this is neutralized. The lack of ideal animal models for the trials. Natural immunity fails to clear the HIV. And then the HIV being retrovirus, integrated the host genome system very soon, being retrovirus. So these are the problems coming in the vaccines. So what has happened? These vaccines have been tried. In USA also they have tried these Vax-10, USA vaccine, Vax-10, Thai trials, then STEP trial, RP-1114, that was in Thai, in the, among the military basically. Well, this vaccine has been found very effective, it has been 30% effective. Other vaccine, none is effective. This is also combination. One is the neutralization and the other is the boosting of the immunity. So 31% effectivity has been found by the RP-114. So the word is hopeful that let's improve this type of vaccine again. So the efforts are going on and they are expecting that next 2 years probably we will get the vaccine also, so that we can reach to the target of AIDS-free generation soon. The vaccine will be helpful reaching the soon. So out of all vaccines, the Thai vaccine, R114 vaccine has been shown effective. Others two vaccines also they are being tried and that will take 2 years for the presence. In India, we have tried 3 candidate vaccines. One is the TGAACO3, then TBCM4. The National Institute of Virology and Indian Council of Research, they have tried these 3 vaccines, but they have not been licensed and they have not been found very effective. The therapeutic vaccines also have been tried in various fields. The coaxing the HIV to come to the bloodstream and then neutralizing it and then boosting the immunity. This is also going on. They are using a drug known as remdesivir, coaxing the HIV virus to come for the kill. So these are the things in the vaccines. So just to conclude, so today is the World Health Day, so it is our chance that we should advocate, we should educate, and we should try to achieve the AIDS-free generations and help in all the societies, being doctors and nurses and all the paramedical staff. The time is to act now. Thank you.
Right. Reason being, when we were MBBS students, we were taught that sexually transmitted diseases are more common in sadhus, sailors, and students. And he being my student, I might have taught him like anyhow. Now, I will like to continue with the previous topic. First, I want to tell you that in your time, this pneumocystis carinii, now known as pneumocystis gyrovaceae, is not a parasite, it is a fungus. It has now been changed. Then, in the laboratory diagnosis, he has also emphasized about the Western blot test. It is very costly test. And as per NACO guidelines, it is not required because it is very costly. And NACO guidelines, we have 4 types of strategies for HIV testing. Strategy 1 is for blood banking. Strategy 2A is for just knowing the epidemiology of the disease. Third is for the diagnosis in AIDS cases, suspected AIDS cases. And last, third is in asymptomatic cases. Now in case of strategy 1, this is used in blood banking. You have only one test and all these tests are ELISA or rapid tests. No Western blot because that is a costly. So the tests, all these 3 tests, every testing center has to procure 3 tests. And for testing, all these should be either of different antigen preparation or different antigen principle or principle of the test. So in case of blood banking, you test a blood and if it is found non-reactive, it is safe for transfusion. If it is reactive, then you label it positive and incinerate the blood and the donor is referred to ICTC, Integrated Counseling and Testing Center, which is there in microbiology department. There he is tested by 3 tests with pre-test, post-test counseling. So this was for strategy 1. Strategy 2, in this case, it is for sentinel surveillance. You want to know the burden of disease in your community. It is unlinked, anonymous. So you don't need any pre-test, post-test counseling. So you do the first test. If found non-reactive, it is declared as negative. If found reactive, then go to the second test. If second test is again non-reactive, even if the first was positive, you label it negative. In case both these tests are positive, then you declare it as positive. And since it is unlinked anonymous, you don't need to do any counseling. So this was for sentinel survey. 2B, for testing in a case where it is suspected to be a case of AIDS. I may emphasize here that clinician cannot diagnose AIDS. They can only suspect AIDS. It is the laboratory which will say whether the person is suffering from AIDS or not. So in this case, it is already the person is suspected to be suffering from AIDS. Say there is persistent loss of brain, it is disseminated tuberculosis, it is Kaposi sarcoma, this type of symptoms are there, then you do the first test. If found reactive, go to second test. If the second test is also reactive, then you only declare positive. Otherwise, if second test is negative, you say no. But in third category, so which we call it strategy 3. Here it is when you want to know your HIV status, whether you are suffering from HIV or not. So in that case, first test, reactive, non-reactive. Non-reactive, drop it, it is negative. If first test is reactive, go to second test. If second test is also reactive, go to third test. If third is also reactive, only then label him as a case of AIDS, not of, and on the other hand, if second test is non-reactive, third is reactive. Now the problem is first reactive, third reactive, second is non-reactive. It is known as indeterminate. You ask the patient to come after 2 to 4 weeks, repeat it again. If same status continues, you declare it negative, otherwise positive. And similarly, if first 2 tests are positive and third is negative, in that case, again, it is indeterminate result and you have to call the patient after 2 to 4 weeks. So this was, this is strictly NACO guideline. It is the private hospitals which force for this test for Western Broad, because that is costly and they get more money. Western Broad is not required. Not at all required. It is only 3 tests, rapid or ELISA. Thank you very much.
The concept is, we are suggesting, now you still, you are reporting the cases, finding the cases, and leaving the cases again. Where is the follow-up? You have found out so many pregnant women are 30,000 or 60,000 after it. They are saying, yes, but where are they for 20 years? Now we don't have any follow-up. Do you have any record of writing a string with your follow-up, any mechanism and management? Nothing. That is already for guidelines that you please find out what is the difference of HIV positivity in private treatment, same government treatment, more than 10 times. As it, what measures we have taken, how we will be able to stop. Now, whatever the rate you have said, again, see, this is in a organized. This is in the sex workers, which have been managed by NGOs or others. It has gone in the deep interviews. Home-based sex workers have appeared. Where is the doctor? How we can say this has been stopped? When HIV hepatitis B is increasing, and we say HIV is decreasing, unlikely. AIDS is always done by the clinicians. It is a symptomatic. AIDS is never diagnosed by a microbiologist. It is a clinical syndrome. It is that is always bad. So, it is a holistic approach. We cannot treat HIV/AIDS separately. We created 50% more seats in the medical colleges. Not for these army students. It was, where is our, where poor patient is lying? Let us solve the local problems in the local way. We should find out students from those areas that are deprived areas, but they are students from somewhere else. We are very happy we got the 50% seat for our students. Teachers are there, students are there. Will they go there? Will they correct? Certainly not.
I am thankful to everybody, including directors, deans of the various faculties, HODs, faculties, and the students and the other staff.